worship you, Jesus. We worship you, God. Oh, God, your love. You are love, God. We worship you, Jesus. We give you all praise.
Oh, God, my God, I seek you. I want to move and you move. You're more than I could long for. I thirst for you. You're an ocean to my soul,
God.
Father, we thank you. Your love is like a waterfall, God. We ask your grace would be upon us this morning.
Yes.
That you'd wash over us, God.
Yes,
we know we're living in the dry and weary land. But we thank you for your faithfulness in all that we do. We bless you today. In Jesus' name.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. And whatever may pass and whatever lies before, there may be singing when the
a praise to him this morning. We thank you, Jesus. We honor you, Lord. Amen.
That's what it's all about, isn't it? Bless the Lord, all my soul. It's all about him. So, Father, we pray this morning, God, as we continue to worship you. We recognize that it's all about you, God. And, Father, we realize that the essence of who you are is a God that gives. You gave to us when we weren't looking for you. And Father, we want to give thanks. As we remember Thanksgiving, we want to give thanks to you, Father, for your faithfulness, God. You've been faithful throughout the generations. You've been faithful with Abraham. You've been faithful with Moses. You've been faithful with the Apostle Paul, faithful with our families, faithful with us here today. We bless you. We honor you. We want to say thank you, God, for all the good things you give us. We thank you most of all for the blood of Christ, which cleanses us from all sin. In Jesus' name.
this, Lord, we bless you. We honor you, God.
We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is on his throne. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is on his throne.
Goodness in our lives, God. Forever, forever and ever, you beat the power of sin and death. We thank you for the freedom we have in Christ Jesus. Amen and amen. Amen. So good to see you all this evening, or actually this morning. It's so dark, it's evening. But we're so glad to see everyone this morning. We want to go ahead and release the children to Children's Church and also greet your neighbors at this time in Jesus' name. Let's go ahead and do that right now. Let's go.
Good morning. You know, it was mentioned this morning that this is Thanksgiving time. We have an awful lot to be thankful for. First of all, our redemption by the blood of the Lamb and this church. But you know, more so than this church as a building, which is beautiful, it's the souls of the people here. We're so, I'm sure God is so thankful for each one of them. But also we want to recognize in particular, if you would, Pastor, you and your family come forward. Our pastor, Eric Bucci, and his family, Sandra, who's his right-hand lady, Luke on the drums, Hannah, and let's not forget Matthew. I did say Hannah. We're very thankful for them because they've sacrificed probably more than any one of us. They've had to sacrifice to let Dad be here on so many occasions to serve in so many ways so that this might become a reality. And we're appreciative of that fact, and we just want to make it a note here and now that we are, and for the family.
Thank you so much.
And we think that it's time that maybe you took a little break. And we think that you have, and because you owe the family more of your time, I think it's a good thing that we help you get to and enjoy Disney. Was it World or Land? World. God bless you guys.
Thank you. Wow, how about that?
God bless you.
Thank you so much. Wow, I didn't expect that.
I thought it might be Kwasi or something.
Wow. That's so generous of you. Is this thing on? Hello? Is it on? No, it's not on?
Let me say a couple of words before you turn it on, because then he'll, you know, we know Pastor doesn't like interruptions in the service, so hopefully he'll forgive us for this one. Things moving forward. But as a member of the building committee, and I'm representing the entire building committee today, we definitely do want to say thank you to Pastor and Sandra and the children. Last week, you know, he recognized all these people for their aid. And you know, it's not only the quickly for the though. That's what this is.
Thank
your vision and
thank you
your
so
drive.
Much. That's so kind.
Thank you.
That's so kind. You know, We don't do it for that. We do it because we love God. And we know we got one trip through this life. And we want to make much of an impact as we possibly can. And I'm so blessed to be in a church that wants to do the same. So thank you so much. And I didn't expect that. I don't do it for that reason. And the reason we do it, because we love God. And we love you. We believe in you. We believe what God can do. God's looking for a church, which we're going to share. I'll preach later about that. But God's looking for a church that will say yes to him. Amen. Because how many folks know in this day and age, we need people that are going to say yes to God and no to the world. Amen. So thank you so much. I really appreciate it. I was totally caught off surprise. I thought maybe it'd be like, you know, Carmen Anthony or something like that. I had no idea. And I'm a little embarrassed, a little uncomfortable, but nevertheless, I have to learn how to receive grace as much as give grace. So thank you so much, everybody. Really appreciate it.
Yep.
Thank you.
I'd like to pray for the family, though.
Yes,
quickly.
We appreciate that.
If you all would reach out and agree with me in prayer as we pray for the family. Father, we thank you for Pastor Eric and Sandra and Luke, Hannah, and Matthew, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, for their dedication and their sacrifice to you and to the kingdom of God, and also to this body, Lord God. We thank you for the love that they show always, continually, to each and every one of us and the love they have for you. And Father, we ask that you would continue to bless them, Lord God. Bless them, Lord, with your peace and with your joy and with your health, O Lord God. Happiness, O Lord. Keep them close as a family,
yes,
Lord God, always. Keep them healthy. Keep them strong, O Lord God. And Father, we pray a hedge of protection around them, that as the enemy tries, because we know he will, they're doing a great work in this area, that as the enemy tries, Lord God, let our prayers and let our love surround them, Lord God, and let your presence surround them and keep them safe. We cover them with the precious blood of the Lamb, and we thank you once again for them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you so much, everybody. Thank you. That's so kind. That's so kind. That's so kind. That's so kind. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Well, it's hard to follow that, but at this point in the service, I just wanted to go ahead and welcome everybody here this morning. We're so glad everybody is here, and it's such a beautiful day to be in God's house and to just celebrate his faithfulness and his goodness. If you look inside your bulletin, you will see a lot of events that we have going on here at Cornerstone. Just take a look through them, and inside you will also see our Cornerstone Connection card. That is just our way of getting a little information about you. So if it is your first or second time here, or if you've never filled out a connection card, we kindly ask that you would fill it out and turn it into one of our greeters at the end of service. And we have a special gift for you to thank you for coming out here this morning. Also, if you will be attending any of our events coming up, you have an opportunity to do so on the back. And you can return this to one of the greeters or ushers. And you'll also notice on every exit now we have offering boxes for your convenience, so you could stick that card in there as well. I did want to mention that today, immediately following the second service, we will have Growth Track 101, which is an opportunity to learn a little bit more about Cornerstone. A meal will be served, and it'll be a great time of fellowship, and you can learn about membership at Cornerstone. And with that, we're going to go ahead and roll the announcements.
Welcome to Cornerstone Church. We're so glad you can join us today. Here are some key announcements for this week. Let's get started. December 7th will be Christmas caroling at the Rose Garden Health Center. Our children's Christmas play holds a rehearsal today after second service. We'll hold the special candlelight service on Christmas Eve at 6 p.m. Teen Laser Tag takes place November 23rd at 6 p.m. Operation Christmas Child Shoeboxes are due back November 23rd. Find out all about Cornerstone Church November 23rd at Church 101. More events and information can be found inside your bulletin or on our website. Fill out your connection card here or complete it online at cornerstonechester.com.
All right.
We hope you have a great day.
You too, Don. We appreciate Don. Anyhow, let's go ahead and call the ushers up, and we want to give back to what the Lord's given to us. And I tell you, the Bible says in Thessalonians, give thanks always for all things. And we have a lot to be thankful, don't we? I mean, especially I all caught off balance here a little this morning, being surprised like that. But nevertheless, the greatest gift we have is Jesus Christ, amen. Our families, each other. Amen. So, Father, we pray you bless this offering. In Jesus' name, we ask that you be honored through it. We thank you for the opportunity to give and sow back into what you've given to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Before we show a little video, last week was a very jam-packed service. I wanted to recognize a few folks that made last week possible. Last year, Louise Anderson and her husband were on the beach on vacation, and she had these, while she's on the beach, she had dreams of ice. And she saw these ice sculptures, and she had to came back. I had like an epiphany encounter on the beach, and told us about how we could celebrate. And I don't know about you, but I thought last week was fantastic. Hey, can we just thank Louise for helping with that? And amazing. It was absolutely amazing. It wasn't it a fantastic time last week to have everyone celebrate what God is doing? And my mom and dad were so happy. My father said one of the best days of his life to see his entire family worshiping God in the front. And seeing the fruit of his labor of all these years. And so I'm honored that I could honor my dad by being faithful to God. And I think that's the greatest honor that any parent would want to their children. And so it's been a gracious time. I'm really excited what's happening in our church and what God is going to do and continue to do. And so that's what's going on with that. Listen, last week we had so much going on. We were supposed to have Dave Wagner be here, but he has been suffering tremendously this past year. His pastor died of cancer. He's been through so much stuff. He's a great guy. If you know David Wagner, he's been with us for a number of years when we were, about maybe a third of the size we are now. He spoke to us that you're going to be a church of over 500 real soon. And he talked about all these things we're going to do. And like, okay, yeah, that's fine. And you know, not only that, but Sandra and I had two miscarriages. And we had Luke and Hannah. We're like, you know what? We're good. We got the boy. We got the girl. All we need is a white picket fence, a dog and a cat and a canary. And we're good to go. And we were sitting there one Sunday in the old building. And he looked at my wife, Sandra, and he said, by this time next year, you're going to have a baby boy. And I tell you, the blood drained out of my face. I said, oh, my God, this guy's lost it. You don't do that. You don't prophesy that kind of thing. Number one, it's very dangerous. Number two, he better hear from God or I'm never having him back. And, of course, later on that same year, following year, we had a child. Now, faith without works is dead. But nevertheless, we had Matthew, which is a great gift from God. And he's been a great friend of the house of Cornerstone. We're so appreciative of him. And he was so gracious enough to give us a word. I'm going to ask the gentlemen in the back, if they'd be so kind, and the ladies in back too, to go ahead and show that video. It's about 4 minutes long. He's going to be sharing with us what he thinks as he prayed about our church. Go ahead, guys. Thank you.
Hello, Cornerstone Church, right there in Cheshire, Connecticut. I'm sorry I can't be with you in person to celebrate the dedication of your amazing new sanctuary. I really love your church and love Pastor Eric and Pastor Sandra and the leadership team there. And I really just love the congregation. It's one of my favorite places on the planet. As I've just been praying about this dedication for you guys, I really felt like the Holy Spirit said that he didn't just build the sanctuary, but he was building a memorial. He was building a miracle memory bank for your children and your children's children, that they'll look back for generations to come, and they'll talk about how they remembered God being faithful and how God provided for not only the sanctuary, but for the ministry to reach a city. And I feel like prophetically the Lord is asking you this question. Do you want to take a city? Do you want to take the town of Cheshire? I really believe that it's a season of amazing harvest for you right there at Cornerstone Church, that God has made you a fortress for families. He's made you to be a prophetic outpost for that region, to be an apostolic resource center, to train people up and to send them all over the earth. I believe that God is about to release a greater realm of his presence and his glory, not only in your meetings, but upon the families of Cornerstone right there in Cheshire. I really believe that the hand of the Lord is about to move, that he's about to provide like never before, but he's also about to show forth his strong right hand. The Bible says that the Lord looks to and fro the earth, looking for those who are loyal to him, so that he can show his strong right hand. And I believe just the hand of the Lord is getting ready to be released. He's about to release that open-handed blessing upon you. But I also believe that the Lord is getting ready to release an impartation because the greatest days of Cornerstone are right in front of you. I really believe that the Lord is about to release an amazing outpouring of his Holy Spirit upon you as a church body. And I feel from the youngest to the oldest and the oldest back down to the youngest, there's a multi-generational move of the Holy Spirit that is taking place there at Cornerstone Church, and I'm so excited to be a part of it. And I just really feel right now that the hand of the Lord is coming to put keys into your hands this morning. I believe he's getting ready to just release to you keys that open up dimensions of his heart that he created just for you. So Father, I just thank you right now, Lord, for Cornerstone Church of Cheshire. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, Lord, over this last season, Lord, as they built this sanctuary for your glory and for the advancement of your kingdom. And Lord, I thank you right now. I hear you saying in my heart and in my spirit that you're moving this church, Lord, into miracle territory. And they've not seen anything yet compared to what they're about to see. Lord, I thank you that you're about to advance your kingdom in them and through them. And Lord, they're about to see things they've never seen before. They're about to hear things they've never heard before. And they're about to do things they've never done before. Lord, I thank you for that outpouring of your Holy Spirit today. Lord, I thank you that, Lord, today that Nehemiah call, Lord, has been answered by Cornerstone Church of Cheshire. That, Lord, they're standing in the gap. That, Lord, you didn't just build a sanctuary, but Lord, you're building a testimony in that place. That, Lord, they will be like Nehemiah. They will stand on the wall. And Lord, I just ask right now that you would release 52 days of miracles, Lord, that we release into 52 weeks of miracles. Lord, just release miracle after miracle in Cornerstone Church right there in Cheshire, Lord, Lord, throughout the next year. And Lord, I just release blessing over them. Lord, I thank you for their friendship. Lord, I thank you just for the years that we've tarried and we've walked and we've ministered together. And Lord, I bless my friends at Cornerstone this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, Cornerstone Church. We hope to see you soon.
Amen. It's so good to hear this word from David. And so he's a good dear friend of our church, and hopefully he'll be back next year to be with us again. And I just believe, you know, we're going to be talking about that in just a little bit, about prophetic and all that kind of thing. So hang on to that. But I just want to mention something real, real quick. If you've been coming to this church, we want to encourage you. If you're not already a part of the Cornerstone team, we're having a special. I know Jessica mentioned it was in the video. It's called Church 101 at 1230, 1245. And it's in Sal's house. And I know it's confusing now because, you know, we need to get a map, which we're working on, by the way. We're not done yet, by the way. We're still doing a punch list. We're going to have signs and all that kind of thing to help people find where it is. But Sal's house is when you first pull into the church, there's a little house on the right-hand side. It's called Sal's house. And it's one of the founding members. In there at 1245 after the second service, we're going to have a special lunch and give you an opportunity to hear about Cornerstone Church, a full lunch, hear about where we're going as a church, what the vision is, and how you can participate if you want to. And that's really what it is. And that's coming after the second service, okay? I wanted to mention one other thing to you is that it's time to get ready to open the Word of God. I think I'd give all the announcements. Let's go ahead and prepare ourselves for this today's message, which is about seasons. In a new season, and that's what we're talking about this last period of time. And we're talking about change and how new seasons come, and we're in the middle right now. And I don't know about you, it seems like we hit high gear turbo nitrous oxide into winter. It means we've gone from fall right into the middle of winter. But we go through different seasons in our lives, and one of the most important things that you and I can do when we're living our lives is to learn how to navigate in the seasons that God places us in. It's so important to understand what season you're in and act accordingly. For example, when you have little children and they're in their diapers and all that, there's a different season. You can't do much but be inside the house, and then they grow up. There's different seasons when you're young, when you're middle-aged, and when you're in your golden years. There's all types of seasons. There's also seasons in a church. But one of the things that we find is this, that change is inevitable. No matter if you like it or not, change is always happening. Question is, what are we going to do with the change that's happening? Sometimes we think we can stay the same. But you know what? We can't stay the same. You know, right now, millions of cells are dying and millions of cells are being rebirthed in your body as I speak. Right now, the universe is moving at an incredible rate of speed. Our galaxy is moving right now. Nothing's ever the same. And we mentioned the fact that God is forever. He's forever and ever. He says, I am God. I do not change. And then people say, well, that's the case. Why does he say, behold, I'm doing a new thing? Because God's so huge, so big, we can't comprehend him. He's always doing something new because he's God. But his character's not change. So how do we deal with these seasons of change? And I want to share with you today, it's very simple as this. Moving from pathetic change to prophetic change. Moving from pathetic change to prophetic change. Now, I'm going to define that just in a few moments so you know what we're talking about. What does that mean, pathetic change? Well, pathetic, every year said, that's pathetic. You know, I worked all hard and nothing happened. That was pathetic. It means pitiful. It means horrible. It means negative. And like it or not, we have a choice in the kingdom of heaven. Do you either go for prophetic change or pathetic change? There's two ways to look at life, pathetically or prophetically. And I'm going to share with you, but by the end of today, I hope we're going to have a good idea. We're going to do a case study of three different people in the Bible, just briefly. And we're going to look how it affects us as a church and as individuals, from pathetic change to prophetic change. Now, prophetic means seeing what God says and proclaiming it before it happens. Seeing prophetically. And I pray by the end of this message today, you're going to get a good idea of the next stage God is bringing us to as a church in regards to how we're supposed to interact with each other and the Lord God himself. So what is that supposed to mean? I want to share with you what that means prophetically. How many of you heard of, if you open your Bibles, please, to Judges chapter 6. How many of you have ever heard someone say something negative? Oh, it's no use, you can't change, or this is the way it's going to be. And I've seen it in my life. I've seen people say things to me, oh, you can't do this, you can't do the other. Often people say negative things like that. You ever experienced that? Or you're going through a difficult time. Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. I'm getting all blessed today. This is crazy. Water and everything. Okay. But have you noticed that begins to happen? People say ridiculous things, and they're so, they don't see what's happening. And sometimes we get down, and sometimes we don't know what's happening. But I remember there's a man, you might have heard of him. He's a little boy that grew up in the inner city, and he was with his mother had no husband. He had two children. She couldn't read or write. She worked hard and worked really hard for these kids. She's basically in the ghetto, in a really bad section, a lot of crime, a lot of stabbing, some shootings. But she believed in her children. She believed, even though her husband walked out on them, she believed something better for her kids. She saw prophetically what these children could be. And so what she began to do is she didn't act on what she saw in the natural. She looked at what she saw afar off. And she began to speak prophetically on them. I want you to make a book report every single week. I want you to read these books and make a book report. So her kids would come back, and they give her a book report every single week, all through grade school. And the funny thing was, this woman could not read. And she raised one of the most prestigious neurosurgeons named Ben Carson. Have you ever heard of him? He separated Siamese twins that were one of the first that it's ever done. And now he might be running for political office. Tremendous man of God. But his mother saw beyond the ghetto. His mother saw beyond being a single parent. Mother saw beyond the welfare state. She says, I believe in better for my son. I see prophetically. Judges, you find Gideon hears the folks. I mean, and as you give you about 50, every time there's a paycheck, someone's going to come and steal it from you. And so what happened on that day, they used to have grain and wine presses and olive presses and things of that nature, and they would try to harvest the grain, and as soon as they did, the Midianites would come and take their food from them, and they'd have to squalor around and try to beg for it because the Midianites were so much stronger. And so here's Gideon just having a rough time with this. And 7 years goes by, and Gideon, what he's doing is he's on the threshing floor where they used to do take grain, and they'd beat the grain until the grain would come out and take off the chaff of the grain. And they used to do it out in the open, but he did it in a wine press, hiding by a tree for fear that his sustenance would be taken from him. Now, I don't know about you, but that seems kind of pathetic to me, kind of sad. Here I am serving God. I've done all I can. I'm tithing. I'm giving to the church. I'm giving to the help. I'm giving to the poor. I'm reading my Bible. I'm praying. I'm raising my kids. I'm working 3 jobs. I still can't pay the bills. The bills are hills I can't seem to climb. And you're wondering what's going on, and here's Gideon the same way. It's pathetic. It's a pathetic situation. What's going on, God? Where is God? Where's God in the middle of this difficult time? And so that brings us to the passage of the context and Gideon, Judges 6. If you want to follow along the scriptures, I'll put it on the screen. We're reading from the New Living Translation, and then we're going to go to New King James as well. It says in verse 12, bringing up to speed, the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said, this just blows me away, mighty hero, the Lord is with you. I mean, think about this. You're hiding, thinking you're going to get beat up or stolen from. You're fearful. You're hiding in your basement. You're hiding in your attic. You're hiding behind the garage. Wherever it is, you're hiding. You're afraid what's going to happen to you. And all of a sudden, God shows up with an angel and says, oh, mighty man of valor. What? I'm fearful right now. I'm scared. I'm hiding for 7 years. Look what happens. It's an amazing story. Mighty hero, the Lord is with you. Sir, Gideon replied, if the Lord is with us, have you ever said this? why has all this happened to us? I don't know about you, but if an angel showed up, I'd be freaking out. And he's having dialogue with the angel. He's saying, hey, if God is real, an angel showed up, why has all, how many of you ever thought that? If God is real, then why did my mom or dad die of cancer? Why do I have this disease? Why did my spouse walk out on me? How come my parents don't care about me? How come I try so hard in school, nothing happens? How come I can't have enough money to pay the bills? How about I can't find a job? If God's such a good God, then where is he? Well, Gideon was in that company. And Gideon was in a pathetic state. But God came to him in that pathetic. Now, this is what I find so encouraging. It wasn't like Gideon was up there, you know, singing, Lamb upon the throne forever. He, you know, sitting there with his iPod in the wine press worshiping God. God, I believe you for the best. No, he wasn't believing God for the best. He was trying to sustain himself and protect himself from being hurt and being robbed. He was not in a state of faith. He was in a state of fear. Obviously, why? Because look where he was. And look at his response to the word of the Lord. Wait a minute here. If the Lord is with us, does that sound like a man of faith? No. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad the Bible is so, like, so vivid? It shows these men and women as being real people with real problems in a real world. How many folks know we are real people with real problems living in a real world? And thank God for these chronicles and these true stories that help us to see that God is faithful. So here's Gideon, discouraged. How many of you might be discouraged today? We're going to be having a series starting, not this week, but the following week. It's going to be called Holiday Photo Bombs. And we're going to be talking about when things screw up, when your picture-perfect life goes back. So I want to encourage you to invite your friends to this series, because how many folks know we're coming to a season of holidays that's a very difficult season for many, many people. And we should be couriers of light. Nevertheless, back to what we're talking about. Mighty Hero, the Lord is with you. Because where are all the miracles my parents told me about, our ancestors told us about? Didn't they say the Lord brought us up from Egypt? But now the Lord has abandoned us and handed us over to the Midianites. My goodness, God just called him a mighty man of valor. Does that sound like a mighty man of valor to you? If I was the angel, I'd say, dude, what's your problem? I'm an angel. I came down here from heaven. I don't want to be here on earth. I just told you you're a mighty man. What the heck's your problem? Slap, slap. I beat him up. What's your problem? How many people see angels? What's wrong with you, Gideon? And it's amazing. He's not showing any faith. He's not showing any leadership. He's showing a pathetic state. Yeah, what does the angel say? Then the Lord turned to him and said, go with the strength you have. I love it. Go with the strength you have. God doesn't ask us to go to the gym and bench 350 pounds when we never lifted a weight in our life. He says, go in the strength you have. Give what you have. The strength you have, walk in it. And the Lord says to us today, whatever place you are in your life, if you don't have a job, or if you do have a job, or your marriage is going good, your family is going good, whatever the situation, but God doesn't ask us to be something we cannot be. He just simply says, go in the strength that you have, and guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to join with you. Jesus says, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. Cast upon me your cares, and I care for you. But what is so interesting is, Jesus says, what? My burden is light, but guess what? There's still a burden we have to put under the yoke of our neck, but we're going with Christ. Go in the strength that you have. My friends, sometimes we wait for the strength to come. We're waiting for an epiphany moment. We're waiting for God to show up on a white horse, and God says, hey, why don't you just get up, get dressed, take a shower, go to work, read the word, go to church, and trust me, and the strength you have, do it, and I'll meet you there. And so the story of Gideon is an amazing story. We don't have time today to talk about it, but he ended up being a deliverer. And he really, this guy Gideon, you see the kind of person he is. I love him. He has so much doubt. An angel shows up. An angel, he brings a sacrifice, and the God consumes it with fire. He still doesn't believe. I mean, you think he'd believe by now. And then he asks for the fleece. You heard of the fleece? Okay? So we don't have time to get into all that. But Gideon, and what did God do with this man? God has prophetic vision for you and for me and for this church. No matter how pathetic your situation could be, God has prophetic vision. What is that supposed to mean? That means he sees what can happen in you. He sees what can happen in your life. He doesn't see what you are. He sees what you can become. And that's the beauty of God. And if we're going to be godly, we're going to have to start learning to do the same. We're going to have to start seeing people not where they are, but where they can be. We need to start seeing God's potential in people and begin to call it out even when there's no indication it's even there. Now, we're going to share this and balance it in a few moments, but how can that possibly be? So you hear this. Go with the strength you had in verse 14 and rescue Israel from the Midianites. And it's amazing. And look what he says. I am sending you. You think that'd be enough, but what does he have to say next? Gideon replied, how can I rescue Israel? My clan is the weakness of the whole tribe of Manasseh, and I'm the least in my entire family. I don't have an education. I didn't go to school. No one follows me. People say I'm a leader, but when I take a walk, no one follows me, so I'm just taking a walk. And I'm the least of my family. The Lord said, I will be with you, and you would destroy the Midianites as if you're fighting against one man. My friends, God can destroy the enemies of your life. Strive the enemy of depression, the enemy of a bad marriage, the enemy of discouragement, the enemy of not having enough money or having a job. Listen, if we'll just walk in the strength that you have and trust God and keep doing the right thing and don't give up, God's going to meet you in that place. It may not be what you want, but the Bible says, I've been old, I've been young, and I am old. I've never seen the righteous begging for bread. God will take care of us if we will trust him. He may not give you your greeds, but he'll give you your needs. And so it's an amazing thing that happens. And, you know, I find it very interesting how we often prophetically call to each other. Have you noticed that? I just want to show you a couple of the scriptures about this. How many of you ever heard of a person by the name of Moses? I'm going to just summarize. You know, Moses had a great education and grew up in the best place, the best schools, the best military academies in Egypt. If you remember the story, he was born in Egypt under slavery, and his mother had to hide him because Pharaoh was killing the Israelite boys because they were afraid they were going to overtake the Egyptians, and they hid him in a basket. Pharaoh's daughter found him and raised him as one of her own sons, had the best education possible at the ripe age of 40, which is often the place where people take off in their careers and doing well. What happens? He says, I'm going to rescue my people. And what does he do? He tries to do it. He ends up killing an Egyptian, tries to hide the Egyptian. The next day, he sees two Israelites fighting. He says, hey, why are you fighting? Who are you to judge us? Are you going to kill us like you killed the other man? He ran off into the wilderness. And what did he do? He became a shepherd. And you know what's so interesting about being a shepherd? He did one of the worst things possible. He was herding sheep. Egyptians saw shepherds as the scum of the earth. They were septic tank pumpers, okay? That's what they were. They were like the least job in the world. And here's Moses going from the palace to the pigsty. Here he is taking care of sheep, which is like shameful. And at the end of his, towards that part of his life, what happens is God meets him in the burning bush. He says, I've called you to deliver the people. He says, what? Me? I stutter. I'm slow speech. I can't put two words together. What do you mean you're calling me? God had prophetic vision to see not where Moses was, but where Moses could be. My friends, it's time that you and I have prophetic vision, not only for yourselves, but for each other. There's people out there looking for hope. Every person has a redemptive purpose. Every person on the planet, God wants to save. And every person has potential for greatness. My friends, it's our objective and our design to go out there, share the good news, and let people understand there is a good road for you. There is peace for you. There's a better way for you. And what happens to Moses? Moses has to do something. He has to throw down. He says, how am I supposed to do it? He says, what's in your hand? What's in his hand? A staff. What's in his staff? Representing being a shepherd, a shameful thing. God says, what's in your hand? My shame. He says, throw your shame down. He throws his shame down. What happens? It turns into a snake. If you're willing to throw down your shame, Throw down your pain. Throw down the things that you don't like and say, God, I give it to you. You said you'll be with me. You said I can do all things through Christ. Well, God, you know I'm slow of speech. God, you know I suffer with a bipolar. God, you know I have two divorces. God, you know I struggle with my finances. God, you know I can't seem to go to school. I can't seem to put 2 + 2 together. God, I'm a mess, God. But guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to throw it down. I'm going to throw it down, God. And watch what God will do. Well, thank you for that. Appreciate good preaching there, right? You're not amen as good as I'm preaching now here. This is good stuff. I'm just saying the scripture, not me. Okay, here we go. But, you know, this is what's happening here. So we see that happen. You know, what I find so interesting is this. I want to talk about the pathetic. Two basic types of being pathetic, and we're running out of time, so we're going to get there. And this is the thing that drives me crazy. Have you ever noticed, like, you're just going down the road or something, you're walking, and you go, oh, excuse me. Someone goes, oh, watch your step. Okay, why didn't you tell me that 2 seconds ago? I just tripped. I just hit my head on the doorpost, and now you're telling me to watch my step. Thank you for your ingenious wisdom. That does me no good. All right, how about this? Someone loses a job, and you have the audacity to go up to him, hey, you should look for a job. Really? You think I need to look for a job? Thank you so much. Someone just struggles in sin, and you go over and, you know, you're sinning. Really? I mean, you know, I'm not saying we don't bring correction, but please understand me. Sometimes we state the obvious, and what we begin to do, we state where the person is without faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Jesus looks at people and does not see where they are, but sees where they can go. The same time, Jesus saw Peter. He said, Peter, you're a rock. What do you mean I'm a rock? What do you mean I'm a rock, Peter? I'm going to build my church on your testimony. And amazing enough, 2 verses later, he screws it up again. And then later on, he denies Christ 3 times. And he's running, and Jesus says, I believe in you. I don't see you where you are. I see what you can be. I have prophetic vision for you. I see prophetic change. I want to turn your pathetic change into prophetic change. And this morning, God wants to take your pathetic change, because my friends, we're always changing, and turn it into prophetic change to what God would have us to be. I love what it says in Romans 5, 6 through 9. You can put it up there, New King James Version. For when we were still without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely a righteous man will die, yet perhaps for a good man, someone will even dare to die. But God demonstrated his love towards us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, having been justified by his blood, we shall be saved. Now, what is that supposed to mean? That means we weren't even looking for God. He was looking for us. He saw us prophetically of what you and I could be, not where we are. You see, we need to understand something. God has a good plan for every person in this room, every person listening to the sound of my voice. God has a good plan, plans for a hope, plans for a future. What do you mean about, what about difficulty? Listen, this earth is not all there is. The best days, you hear me say it all, are always ahead for those in Christ Jesus. And so how is that supposed to work? You look at Peter. God called him out. And then how about this? I love this guy. Have you heard Zach? You might have heard of Zach. Zacchaeus. Who was Zacchaeus? Zacchaeus was the scum of the earth. He was the dregs. He was horrible. He was a tax gatherer. He was a tax collector. Tax collectors in the day of Christ were Jewish. Okay, it's one thing the Romans oppress you. Okay, they're your enemies. But when someone in your own family oppresses you, that's a whole other story. And so what these tax gatherers would do, he would use a Jewish man. You know the story? He was a wee little man. A wee little man was he. He climbed up to the sycamore tree. Okay, that's right now. Not even in the scripture, by the way. But nevertheless, he was a short little guy with a Napoleon syndrome, okay? And this guy was, he was merciless. He would tax people. You owe the government, let's say you owe the government $1,000. He says, give me 3. What? Okay. Then I'll send the Roman guards over to your house, and they'll turn it over and make you a mess. So give me 3. Please, please. All right, $2,500. He'll give $1,000 to the Romans and take $1,500 for himself. That's the kind of person he was. He was horrible. He was extraordinarily rich. he was driving around an Escalade 2016 Platinum Edition XL. And you're driving around in a Ford Pinto from 1973 with blue smoke coming out the back. This is the kind of guy it was. He was horrible. He was absolutely horrible. And what happens to him? I'm saying Zacchaeus knows that there's something better in his life. He has a glimpse of me, a horrible person. And what does he do? He doesn't care. He runs up into a tree. And here's Jesus walking by. And he looks up into a sycamore tree. And what does he say? Zacchaeus, get your act together. Repent. Come down here right now and lay your burden down. No, what does he do? House today. What? Hey, Zacchaeus, I'm going to your house today. You know what he's saying? He's saying, hey, David, I believe in you. Even though I believe in you and I want to have fellowship with you. To eat at someone's house in that day was basically embracing them, saying, I accept you. Now, he wasn't accepting his sin. But people don't care how much you know until how much they know how much you care. You can't save somebody if you hope they go to hell. You can't save your kids if you're so angry. You can't save your spouse if you can't stand them. You got to have love. And what happens? He says, Zacchaeus, you come down. I'm going to your house today. What happened? Zacchaeus right there got saved. Why? Because Jesus had prophetic vision to see what he could be from the scum of the earth. To a tremendous man of God that over 2,000 years later, we're talking about this wee little man that climbed a tree. Maybe you're a wee little person. Maybe you're struggling. I don't know. Maybe you got shame in your life. Jesus is looking up at you and saying, hey, I got prophetic vision for you. I believe good things for you. Why not believe that? Why not believe that? And so we often have people that are negative, but they're very negative. They see the obvious. Well, you know, you can never do that. You know, can't you see what's going on? The economy's bad. They tell you all these things. We talked about it before. And they always see the negative. They state the obvious. They state where you're at. Listen, it can happen to Sandra and I, too. We're growing very fast, which is a great thing. But with growth comes pain. And all of a sudden, you know, I'm sitting there, I'm vacuuming floors. And I can say to myself, no one helps in this church. It's all Sandra and I. Instead, I say, no, I believe in the people of Cornerstone. I believe people want to make a change in this planet. And I believe that God's calling every person to step up and to join together as a team. I believe God is sending us people. And I'll begin to see and prophetically speak things that are not yet as if they are and see them. You know, I give the story. When we called time to build the church, some dear friends said and stopped my wife into the grocery store and said to her, you tell your husband he shouldn't be building right now. The economy's bad. She comes home and tells me. Then it was like a punch in the gut. Oh, this is someone I really care about said that to me. And I'm like, you know, God, you said to go forth. I'm going to believe beyond the economy. Okay? I'm believing in this church. I believe God's looking for a church that's going to say yes to him, as David Wagner said. Prophetically seeing what's not there as if it is there. That's called faith. And so you understand that God has good plans for you. I don't think anyone in this room is as bad as Zacchaeus. At least I hope not. If you are, there's still hope for you. It says, we just mentioned about Romans. And it's so interesting when you talk about this different prophetic change and the pathetic change. And pathetic, negative, stating the obvious after your trip. They're saying there's a problem. You know the common ingredient about everything we're talking about today? What's prophetic? Let me talk about another pathetic. One pathetic change is a person that finds everything wrong. That's all they do is they point the, they're the Eeyores of the world. They're the spiritual gift of Eeyore. They're negative. They're pig pens. They always have a cloud of negativity around them, and they always state the obvious bad thing. Every time you're with them, you feel discouraged. You can have the best day in the world. This person comes in, and somehow, someplace, they're going to find that one speck that's wrong. Yeah, it was good, but you know how it was. And they see something negative. That's cool. That's a pathetic change person. There's also another pathetic change person, and this is the person that doesn't live in reality. They're the people that we're not going to keep score in a soccer game. What? We're not going to keep score in a baseball game. Why? We want everyone to win. And your kids come home with a trophy. What'd you get that for? We won. What did you do? I don't know. We all got trophies. Then you get out of school, and you're like, I want a job. And you have no job. Why? Because there are winners, and there are losers in life. That's the way it is. Life isn't fair.
And so you want to live in this mirage and tell people, hey, just all you got to do is go to school. You graduate, and you're going to have a brand new house, a brand new car, $150,000 a year salary with 4 weeks vacation, and a Mercedes E-Class, baby. That's what's going to happen. You get out, and you're expecting that. Why? Because I've been told all my life that I'm a good person, and I can do anything I set my mind to. You know what? You cannot do anything you set your mind to. Listen, I can't. I'm just not in my mind. I'm just, that's not me. You know, I can't be a mathematician. It's not me. It's just not me. And so I can think, no, be realistic, folks. So there's people that are pathetic. They're always negative. And there's also the pathetic folks that think all the things are going to be syrupy. No, you're going to have to do what? What did God tell Midian? Go with the strength you have. So be realistic, yes. Yes, I'm weak. Yes, I don't have a job. Yes, I'm depressed. Yes, things are going horrible. Yes, this and the other. But I'm going to trust God, and I'm going to trust Him one day at a time. And I'm going to believe God that He is the best for me. I'm going to believe God for the best. Listen, when you start thinking that, you start thanking God. The Bible says give thanks for God in all circumstances. It doesn't mean you thank God that you stubbed your toe. Ow, I lost my job. Praise God. No, it's like, God, even though I lost my job, I thank You. You're with me. You'll never leave me, you'll never forsake me, you'll give me everything I need. I'm gonna trust You, God, that You're a faithful God. So that's pathetic. Well, how do we get positive then? Well, as we think about Thanksgiving, Thanksgiving sets us up with the ability to have prophetic change instead of pathetic change. Why not start being a people? It's kind of sad to me. I'm a little sad. Thanksgiving used to be a lot more celebrated in our culture. Have you noticed? Almost bypassing it. From Halloween to Christmas. Whoop, forget about Thanksgiving. Why? It doesn't make enough money for us. All we're going to do is buy some turkey, some cranberry sauce, for crying out loud. We want to have Black Friday on Thursday. We want people not even sitting at the table. We want them to be at the stores so they can get trampled on. Sad. You know, it's an important, probably the most important holiday, I believe, next to Christmas and Easter. It's the fact that it's an opportunity to say thank you. Thank you. Thanksgiving. And so when you're thankful for what God has done in your life, it opens up avenues of belief. When you're thankful for your spouse that may be a louse, but you're saying, God, thank You that I fell in love with this person, even though they're totally a turkey right now. I thank You that there's some redemptive quality. I thank You, Father. I believe, God. I believe that You can do anything. You can live in reality, of course, but not when I thank God for what You're at. A spirit of thanksgiving, what it does is it creates a culture of faith. A culture of faith gives you the ability to do what you cannot do in your own, because it's impossible to please God unless you believe He exists and He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Without faith, it's impossible. And you can't have faith without being thankful. I've never met a negative person that had faith. I've yet to meet anyone that was negative and had faith. I haven't been able to find it. Have you? I haven't been able to find it. Faith and thankfulness comes together. Why? You see beyond the circumstances. You have the long view instead of the short view. The question I want to ask you is this. What kind of person do you want to be? You want to be a pathetic change person or a prophetic change person? What would happen if you went home, and instead of seeing how lousy the house is, or how lousy your children are, how lousy your parents are, how lousy your spouse is, what would happen if you start seeing prophetically what they could be and began to speak it out? You know, and I mean, little Junior does one little thing. You speak good about it. Why not say, listen, I'm blurting off. You see, that's not prophetic. That's pathetic. And so prophetic change sees the opportunity in every set of circumstances, because God is a God of new beginnings. What would happen if you became a person that had prophetic change? You look at your children, you see opportunity. You see your spouse, you believe in your spouse. You see the church, you believe. Listen, they pay people to get on television, and CNN, MSNBC, and Fox News, they all do it. They all just criticize each other all day long. That's not the kind of culture that develops faith. Faith sees beyond what's already there and sees God's potential in every person. My friends, what would happen? Their people are so discouraged. People are walking around. People don't need to slap across the face. They need to know that someone loves them first. I've never seen anyone give their life to Christ without having love in it.
Preaching the gospel without love is not the gospel. It's the gospel twisted as a weapon. The gospel without love is evil.
Whoa.
Yeah. What do you mean by that? What does Satan do? He takes the words of God and he cuts people with it. Without love, the gospel is not gospel. Gospel is good news. Gospel is belief. And so as we conclude today, the question I want to ask you is what kind of person you want to be? Do you want to be the kind of person that sees the problem or sees the solution? You want to be a pathetic change person or a prophetic change person? Why not see the best? Why not call out the best? Yes, we live in reality. I hope I brought the center, the balance for that, the counterbalance about that. I'm not living pie in the sky, not dealing with reality, no, but just seeing the truth in it. What would happen if someone drives by this church week in, week out, says, I don't know why, but I think I need to stop in there. What would happen if you come to church and praying, God, give me prophetic eyes to see people as you see them? What would happen if you, instead of going to the friends you know, you see someone brand new that's kind of awkward, you go up to him and say, and you ask God for a word. God, give me an encouraging word. And you go up to that person, you say, you know what, I can tell you're a person that has great strength and great wisdom, and you're just, and what happens is God says, I can trust this person, and he'll give you a spirit of prophecy. Prophecy is just, we make it so spiritual. All it is hearing from God and saying what he says. That's all it is. What would happen if you began to see people at work and began to speak prophecy over them? Don't get all weird. Oh, God, I see a white horse coming through there with a flame of fire and a dragon. You cut its head off. Why don't you just say, I see you're a person of strength, and you know what? God loves you. Say that. Don't get all weird. If you see the dragon, like, tell us about it. We'll have coffee together. And we'll have a good time. But don't act weird. Just be normal. Jesus didn't walk around, ooh, ooh. Well, they do call him the Holy Ghost. Yeah, but he's not Casper. You know, he's the friendly ghost. No, the Holy Spirit is a spirit. And Jesus came to people at their level of understanding. Well, that, but God wants to become more of a discouraged. There's no hope for them. They don't know what's going on. They're afraid of the economy. They're afraid of diseases. They're afraid of war. They're afraid of violence. They're afraid of schools. And what would happen if you and I were going to, how about you guys, teenagers and people in school? What would happen if you go into a class and you begin to see students that people say are dumb and you see something good in them and you prophetically speak what you see God can do in them? What would happen? Perhaps they'd come to know God. You don't win the world by hating the world. You win the world by loving the world. And the only way you can love the world is to see what God sees in them. So God wants to take our church. He wants his church to be perpetually prophetic changing. A prophetic changing church. That we see people from not where they are, but where God can be them. I believe in you. You are called by God. You're not here by accident. We are an army where God wants to utilize his church to bring the hope of him to the world. You're not just a nobody. You're somebody. You're created in his image. There is a redemptive purpose in your life. God loves you. He's got a plan for you, not just to survive, but to thrive in him. And you can thrive together. If we would join together and say, I want to see the world change one life at a time. I believe in you. I believe in you. Why not can we do that? Let's all stand. Father, I'm tired of being pathetic. It takes no effort to be pathetic. Lord, we recognize that we have been pathetic change people at times. We state the obvious, and we state life without you. God, we want to put aside the pathetic change, and now we embrace prophetic change. God, let us see ourselves, not where we are, but where you're calling us to be. Father, let us see each other, not where we are, but where you're calling us to be. Let us call encouragement out. Let's be like Ben Carson's mom who saw not the ghetto, but saw a world-renowned surgeon, God. Lord, we want to be like you, Jesus, that sees the sinner that's a total scum and says, come, I accept you because Christ accepted me. Father, I ask that this would be a church that is prophetically changing. Father, we thank you for New England, that New England is an area that has the greatest opportunity in the country to see revival because it's the one that needs the most. Father, we thank you for the universities that are around here, the schools. We want to thank you for one of the finest schools in all the nation or in New England. We want to thank you that we live in an area that's unchurched. Father, we thank you. We speak to New England and we say, New England, we believe in you. Connecticut, we believe in you. You are a place of revival. We believe in you. Father, we call out what we do not see. Father, give us eyes of faith. Give us eyes of faith for our marriages. Give us eyes of faith for our health. Give us our eyes of faith for this church, God, that we would be an amazing church, not because of us, but because of the prophetic vision we have together. In Jesus' name. I just wanted, before we know, I've gone a little long. We just talked about Zacchaeus. I'm so glad Zacchaeus is in the Bible. Because maybe some of you feel like Zacchaeus. Maybe you have totally blown it. Maybe you've totally done everything wrong. No one knows the secret you're going through. Jesus would look at you and say, today I want to go to your house. Today I want to accept you. Today I want to embrace you for who you are. Not because of where you are, but where I can take you. I love you so much. And so I'm going to just pray a prayer right now. I'm going to just pray, and you pray the quietness of your heart. If you mean it with your heart, it's a new beginning. Lord Jesus, I thank you for dying on the cross for me. I believe you are the Son of God. I ask you to fill me with your Holy Spirit. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins. I know I can't save myself. You saved me. I ask you to wash my sins away, all of it. And I choose to follow you this day from this day forward. Thank you, Father, that there's a hope and a future for me in Jesus Christ. I bless you and I honor you today in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask if the worship team, I'm sorry, the prayer team will make their way up. And if you need prayer for anything at all, we want to open the altars for you for prayer. This is just a place, we call it an altar because it's just a place where we kind of come before God. We're not better than anybody else. We just want to come alongside of you and say, listen, we believe that God can do something through you. God can and he will. And so at this point, we're just going to go ahead and dismiss the service. You can bring the music up and we're going to have an opportunity to share with each other.
From the start.